Thank you, Fred, and thank you. Thank you for allowing us to be here today. As a Canadian who has lost a loved one this year due to neglect in long-term care, I feel that my path forward and my reason for being here is clear. Through the sadness of the past several months, I've had the opportunity to hear stories similar to mine from family members across the country. Our stories may differ in detail, but the common thread of neglect, abuse, and loneliness never seems to lose its impact. Those of us who have lost loved ones this year have spent so much time grieving, as one would normally do, but we've also been dealing with the aftermath of a system gone so horribly wrong. The mental anguish that accompanies our loss has only been increased by circumstances that were out of our control. It may be timely to focus on the thousands of families across the country who have been impacted by COVID-19 in our long-term care homes this year. But when we look at the true impact of our long-term care systems over the decades, it's heartbreaking to think that millions of lives have been affected by what we have allowed to go on for far too long. Our country has heard the brave stories from families for months, but throughout there has been a collective voice that has been silenced. There are those we need to hear from, those whose experiences have left them mentally anguished and heartbroken as well. This is why it's my privilege today to share with you the voice of two Canadian PSWs who are brave enough to speak and who want you to hear what they have to say. The first person says, "As long as I've been working in long-term care, it has always been short-staffed. Short-staffed has become normal. COVID-19 has exposed the cracks in long-term care, cracks that PSWs have been trying to highlight for many years. The pandemic made the shortcomings worse as procedures changed by the minute, and we were just struggling to keep afloat. What we see in long-term care is institutional living. Our residents are aging, and instead of living their golden years being happy with the care and comfort they need, they are having to live by waiting. I want to say that I have many wonderful residents who treat me like I'm one of the family. You can't help but bond with your residents. You see them almost every day. You know their families, and they know you. The banter and the friendships are genuine. You know their habits, what they like, and what they don't like. You become a part of their lives. When they are gone, they take a piece of you with them, and you grieve because you have loved them. Many PSWs speak out for each other and our residents, but it doesn't seem to make a difference. We make recommendations and suggestions. We get angry and we push back, but the answer is always, where will the money come from? The reply infers that we should stop asking because we aren't going to get what we're asking for. Being afraid to speak up isn't the problem. The problem is that when we do, we just aren't being heard. Every day we risk our lives and those of our families by going into work. We work in prime conditions to contract and spread COVID-19. Being a PSW right now is terrifying, and I don't think anyone is doing anything to protect us. We're losing our skilled and highly qualified PSWs. They're leaving for better paying jobs, which leaves us taking anyone willing to work in long-term care. Lack of training and preparedness for this job then causes a massive revolving door. We cannot seem to keep anyone long enough in long-term care to sustain the sector. My story as a PSW is the same as many out there. The constant struggle to be heard, to advocate for my residents, co-workers, and myself. I beg you to hear me. Listen to our hearts when we say we need help. We are burned out and trying our best to hold on. It's not for us alone, but for the residents that need us and for our families that we leave every day to provide for. We need to fix long-term care. The bottom line cannot be profit-driven. Do the right thing. Help us take care of the many men and women who have served and made Canada the country that it is today. The second PSW, I pose two questions to. What could your home have done better? She replies, in the beginning, they should have provided staff with PPE. It took too long for management to provide the PPE needed. Once it was provided, the issues calmed down. But at present time, we still do not have enough PPE. The second question I asked her is, what was it like for you? What is it like for you as a PSW worker in a nursing home during this pandemic? Her reply is, it is hell. It's hell working in a nursing home. It's awful. It's terrible. Every morning when we go into work, you hear of someone else who's died. During your shift, you hear of another two or three residents who have passed away. It's stressful also that we have to prepare the bodies and bring them out to the paramedics. They won't come into the home. That has been difficult, and there's just been so many deaths every day. I haven't gotten over that. It's very emotional and very stressful, especially knowing when you might be the next person who could end up in the ICU. I don't talk about it much, but it rests on my mind all the time. It has affected me very badly because one of my close friends and colleagues contracted COVID-19 from working in the home. She was in ICU for a long time on a ventilator, and we didn't know if she would survive. What people don't know is the tremendous guilt that we feel every day, knowing we might be the ones spreading the virus to the people that we care so much about. In reading these comments, it struck me how many similarities there are between family members and long-term care staff. We all want what's best for our loved ones. We all see the need for change. We all have grieved the losses that are so unnecessary. We are all struggling with the weight of mental anguish that this year and the decades prior have brought. We all agree that national standards need to be implemented for long-term care. We need accountability as well. We look to our provincial, territorial, and federal governments to make this a reality. Thank you.